Hello on the rockers. Put the kiddies to bed. It's On the Rocks After Dark. We're going to get a little naughtier tonight. With adult content creators, the legendary Reese Rideout is here. With a newbie already making waves, Nick Floyd. And our guest co-host bringing us nightlife goodness and hot topics, Addie Rae. And me, your favorite host with the sassy most. Raise a glass as the drinks begin. It's On the Rocks After Dark.
And most poor suckers are starving to death.
I'd like to propose a toast.
This is On the Rocks with Alexander, where I drink with your favorite celebrities as we talk about fashion, entertainment, pop culture, reality TV, and, well, that's about it. So pop a cork, lean back, and raise a glass to On the Rocks.
Fasten your seatbelt. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Lord have mercy, buns and bows and pantyhose. On the Rocks podcast, a place where we're too glam to give a damn. Follow us on Instagram and TikTok at On the Rocks on Air and on Facebook, On the Rocks Radio Show. Send me an email, book me for a pride, wedding, funeral, quinceañera, bris. I don't care, I'll show up. Info at ontherocksradioshow.com. Send us your comments, your guest requests, and your guest questions. We got guest questions tonight. The show is presented by Straw Hat Media. You can watch and or listen to our now over 350 episodes at ontherocksradioshow.com for free. You can watch us on Apple TV, Roku, Amazon Fire TV, on the outit.tv app, and on Facebook Watch, streaming with pride on SVTV, and on Channel 31 on the East Coast. Hello, East Coast! We proudly tape at UBN Go Studios, your one-stop place for podcasting. All right, let's get this show on the road. Making her guest co-host debut, Addie Rae. She has a BA in liberal studies with well-earned concentrations in human sexuality and creative arts. She currently lives and works as a bartender in Boys Town, West Hollywood. She's passionate about the community and creative placemaking, so you'll likely find her at galleries or film screenings when she's not behind the bar at Mickey's, or a little bird told me maybe in Vegas. I don't know. Please welcome Addie Rae.
Good morning.
Hey, girl. Hey. Good morning. This is your morning, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Get a little bit closer to the microphone.
You can pull it up to your face.
Ooh. No, I love, I call and I'm freaking out. I'm like, I haven't heard from her for like by 1 p.m. And you're like, this is when I wake up.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Gotta love nightlife. What's it like being a straight girl? We'll talk about straight girl in the middle of Boys Town. Is it fun or is it annoying with like every, hey girl, hey?
I adore it.
Okay.
I've always had a very similar group of friends no matter where I've been, so it was just like coming home.
Now, did you come to West Hollywood, if I'm not correct, almost kind of like right before COVID, right?
I moved to LA in the middle of COVID.
Oh my God. As a bartender? What were you thinking?
It's a long story. It might have had something to do with a person.
Oh, what's their name?
His name was Jimmy, is Jimmy, but he's back in Ohio.
Okay. Well, Jimmy's here tonight. No surprise. Can you imagine? All right, but you like it, even though the gays can get a little crazy, a little drunk.
Yeah, but I wouldn't trade it for the world. I love it here.
Okay. Is it hard to date while you're in Boys Town?
Very.
Okay. Well, we're going to talk about dating tonight, too.
Yeah, it's tough to meet people.
Yeah, how do you meet people? I know that there's another straight running around Mickey's, but you can't with coworkers?
I'm not planning on it, no.
Oh, what? He's so cute.
I agree.
But? Too much conflict?
There's enough craziness going on.
There's enough conflict at Mickey's in West Hollywood. If you want to stop by, I'll tell you what nights to stop by for some conflict. Have you ever dated a coworker in nightlife?
No.
No. Okay. No. What's one of the craziest bar experiences you've ever had?
Well, we've worked together. You've hosted some events with performers. And honestly, there was some fascinating demonstrations. Very exciting to watch.
It was during Halloween. We had some other content creators mm-hmm. who were very well endowed.
Yes.
And we had pumpkins. That's all I'm going to say about that.
I took some notes and I tried it out at home.
How?
That's for me to know. And maybe you'll find out.
Yay. Okay. Pumpkins. We got a complaint from Stater Brothers. Like, what did you do with our pumpkins that we donated? Okay. We are talking to two major content creators tonight. Have you ever been tempted or have you never dipped your toes in the adult content world or like an OnlyFans?
I would have so many questions. Maybe I can get them answered tonight before I would try anything. But
have you ever been like tempted?
Absolutely, yeah.
You know, you could do OnlyFans for like stepping on a cake. Like that could be your OnlyFans. Mm. Yeah.
I'd have to know how to bake.
Honey, I'll get your cakes ready. Okay, it's time for the men of the hour. You're going to help me. We're going to do a little hot topics tonight. We're going to talk about their careers. We're going to talk about it all. Joining us, we have Nick Floyd, adult performer, music producer, painter, currently residing in Hollywood. He's from Temecula, which is wine country, by the way, and I'll tell you how I know that. He surrounds most of his paint artwork with dark, surrealistic tropes of the porn world and music. And music-wise, he's releasing, or just released today, an instrumental techno album called Weird Kid After Party. That could also be called, like, my high school, like, years. Weird Kid After Party. Came out today. We're going to actually get a little sneak peek a little bit in a little bit. He made his first splash with Say Uncle Network and is currently a Cocky Boys exclusive and earned a number of noms at this year's Gavian Awards, even though he's a fresh newbie. Please welcome Nick Floyd.
Oh, my God. That was an amazing intro. It's almost like I wrote it myself.
I know. I added a little, by the way. I flourished it.
Yeah.
I did.
You definitely embroidered it. Like, beautifully.
Also joining us, Reese Rideout. He's actually one of the first adult industry stars that I first noticed. Is that a nice way to say it? Yes. Okay. He went from nude photo shoots to filming for gay studios. He's been in the industry for over 20 years, making his big splash with Randy Blue. He's a crossover performer, also filming for straight, trans, and bi markets. He has won many accolades, including CyberSocket's Performer of the Year, Men Magazine's Man of the Year, Fleshbot's Legacy Award, and several other fan-voted awards. He even just hosted the red carpet for not only the Gavian Awards, but also the first male to host the AVN red carpet. He also wrote and created his newest pop song called Cuz Only Fans, and it's now available wherever you stream music. We're going to listen to it because it's a fun take on like an 80s song, Julie Brown, which I love. So we're going to listen to that. And if that wasn't enough, he is one of the first adult content creators to lead in the world of AI. Want Reese as your AI boyfriend? It's possible. And we're going to talk all about that because AI in the adult industry is a really hot topic. So please welcome Reese Rideout.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And I can verify, like, that's your real voice, because, like, we hang out for real.
Oh, like, compared to my AI voice?
Well, no. Or? We've had adult content creators that come in, and they're like, all of a sudden they're talking like this. I'm like, bitch, you're at Mickey's ordering, can I have a Cosmo?
Yeah, yeah.
But that's, like, your real voice.
Yeah, yeah, it's my real voice. Does it sound deep? I mean, it's not as deep as Derek Cage's, but, you know, I'm working on it.
He doesn't talk that way when he's at Del Taco at 3 a.m., I'll tell you that much. okay, we're going to start with, like, the cheesy questions because everybody wants to know how you got into the industry. Reese, how does going from nude photo shoots go to sleeping with men on camera?
Well, it's a progressive. It's gradual. You know, it's the slippery slope, I like to say.
Well, I saw many of the slippery slopes, yes. But how, like, because you were not, gay porn wasn't your goal?
No, well, getting down to Hollywood or LA was my goal. So when I got the opportunity to come down here and film, it was like, wow, you know, being a poor kid growing up Section 8 housing, I had no other way, no opportunity to, you know, to come down. So that was a way down, some money. Started out, you know, jack off scenes. And that's why I say the slippery slope, because then they're like, well, you want a little more money if you jack somebody off? A little more money if they suck you? How about a little more if you suck them? A little bit more if you fuck them. A little bit more if you get fucked. So it just,
nobody's offered me money for that, I'll tell you that much.
Or you could say maybe the uppery slope, I don't know.
Well, all angles, yeah. I saw. Yeah. Now, was it uncomfortable, like, doing your first kind of gay scene?
Well, I was already a professional at masturbating, so...
What's a little bit different with somebody else?
Yeah, well, you know, when you're sitting at 21 years old, like, your dick's just hard for anything.
Oh.
So it just goes up and then boom, you know. I just get a good thought in my mind, and I can hold it throughout the scene until I come.
Okay. Addie, let me ask you this as our straight girl here. I love doing this, by the way. It's my cardio for the day. So there's always, like, the assumption that women are not watching porn the same way that men are. Your experience, I don't know what your porn watching experience is that kind of the case?
I honestly have more male friends than female.
Okay.
But personally, I think women are just as online. Yeah.
Okay, when's the last time you kind of logged on?
Well, I mean, I was researching our
there's hours of research.
you know, fairly regularly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Nick, you kind of were on a break from art school, and got into, like, sewing club fetish wear.
How do you even know that?
Because I do research, bitch.
You do the... dang, okay.
But then how did that lead to camming and then ultimately to adult content.
Well, I mean, going to school for fine arts, you're always in the mindset of like, I'm not a lawyer. I can really just like dip my toe into this industry and not have like the repercussions.
Yeah. You know?
Even my parents are like totally earth muffins. Like they don't even care.
You told them?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, but it's okay. They think I do modeling.
Well, you do.
Yeah, in a sense.
I've seen your Instagram.
Yeah, but it was really just like I got the free time. I quit my burger job, and I'm going to like pursue this like haphazardly, but like full-heartedly, you know? Like, I'm not signed to anyone, but I'm just like post every day. And I jokingly like DM'd a studio, say uncle, like, would love to work with you, LOL. And they're like, let's sign a contract right now. Not right now, but like, it was like the next conversation.
Well, say uncle, you know, they love their newbies. Like, they're known for fresh faces, eager energy.
Good and bad way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah, everyone I worked with, it's like, this is my first scene ever. And I'm like, it could be great.
Yeah, or it could not be. How was it for you? Did you have like nerves? And
I was so nervous. They like red-eyed me to Florida, and I was so tired. But great first scene partner, so lovely. But, you know, like the 9-hour days for the first scene.
After traveling on a red eye?
Yeah, but it was a great introduction to be like, it wasn't an easy stew. So like my future ones, I'm like, well, it wasn't like that. So this is nothing, you know?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Do you watch your own scenes after?
Only the ones I film myself.
Because you have to edit.
Yeah. But yeah. The ones I'm like acting in, it's so embarrassing. I mean, I try my best. Like, I'm like, that Emmy, you know? sometimes. No one agrees, but just me.
I love that graduation one with Roman Todd. No, like, I was in that scene.
Yeah, yeah. No, that one I was proud of. Yeah. But other ones, like early on days. Like,
but you're a newbie. You learn, and it's not like the directors on a set are really focusing on the acting.
No, it's usually even like 5 minutes of the whole video.
Yeah,
but people do clip that and like tweet it at me, like, "What is this?" And it's so like, I know, shut up. So I, you know.
Now, Reese, do you watch your own scenes after?
No, I don't. But editing, so
yeah.
You know, and so for years, I would watch like the acting part and then fast forward. And even with the wife, like, you know, Final Cut came out from Naked Sword, and she's like, we got to watch this.
Because it was an epic. Studios are now doing these epic films with, like, huge budgets, like, special effects, stunts, like, the whole bit. Like, studios are really, I think they're trying to overcome for the OnlyFans industry, but they're really putting stuff together.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, they are. And Mark McNamara did an awesome job. But, yeah, it was, like, Becky's first gay porn to watch, and we just fast forward to, oh, the fucking fast forward.
That's a fun romantic couple night. We're going to talk about your wife, actually. We're going to talk about that whole, that's a hot topic we are going to talk about. That's just very interesting. When did you both start to realize that you were, like, a hit with the fans?
Go for it, buddy.
I mean,
because you become a fan favorite very quickly. Do you know how many messages I got from my friends?
Really?
Yeah, saying, oh my God, he's my favorite. I love him. And,
it did not happen for me overnight. It was very gradual growth, which I think is better for like maybe longevity.
Yeah.
But I think, I don't know, I looked really fugly for like a really long time.
Oh my God.
No, I meant like legit. Like I dressed like grandma core, like vintage wear, but like not the good way. Like hair down to here, like half of it was green.
Oh, wow.
If you did your research, you would know. You know. But it was like,
I think you deleted that from life.
I did.
Yeah, I couldn't find any of that. Internet. God, I wish we had a picture.
I know.
Tony, go search. Actually, don't Google.
I have an Instagram handle. You can no. But I think maybe once there's a, like initial boom, like you like slow a little bit, and then it's like, okay. But it's always people like behind the screen, so it doesn't feel like that real until maybe you get approached in a club, like, is it weird if I know your name?
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay.
Or like if you're on a date or like you're on Grindr.
Oh, that's so annoying though.
Because people always want to know. When you see a porn star on Grindr, you always think it's not real because you're does a porn star need to be on Grindr for?
Yeah, and it's I always take it to like, it's a thank you. I'm glad you watch my stuff. Like, nice to meet you. But sometimes like mid-date, they just pull like the, I've watched everything you've done.
Oh no, that's creepy.
And I'm just like, have you ever had that experience like mid-date or no?
No.
No. Just
okay. That would be so creepy. Do you end the date there or do you finish or I mean
I don't want to sound like a
sound
bitch.
Like it. Take another sip.
Okay. Sometimes I'm like they're really cute. I'm like be my biggest fan, you know?
Okay.
Like let's have some fun. But other times I'm like okay.
Maybe, like, check, please.
Maybe you can leave, you know?
Yeah.
I've got a question.
Yeah, yeah.
So this happens to me and probably everyone a lot, like, send pictures before you meet someone.
Yeah, yeah.
Do people ask you to send pictures, or do they just know where to find them already?
Well, sometimes
especially
it's like
your body parts. We've seen them.
Yeah. Sometimes it's like I send the pictures I post, so it's like, well, obviously you're a catfish.
Do they notice? Do they complain?
Yeah.
Because I would think it's a catfish.
They're good photos, yeah.
But also, like, they know where to find you, and that's, like, that's,
I should take someone.
You shouldn't be giving it away.
Just for Grindr.
Yeah, but then, like, send a picture, like, three fingers up.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
That really, like, makes me, like, want to date you.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, not
already
at all.
Expectations?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, too needy. But no, but I would, because you don't expect to have that direct access. Yeah. And again, the question is, what does a porn star need with Grindr? Because we assume that you guys are sleeping with other people left and right. And the reality is you have to be more careful than mainstream people, because you have to test with the studio for STIs and everything. You can't risk that on a stranger who creeps you out halfway in a date.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's your livelihood. So I think, the old adult stars are cleaner than your average Joe or average Sue.
Now, Reese, you grew up, like, we're talking about 20 years ago, so there wasn't the social media, there wasn't the OnlyFans. The only way to interact with an adult star was getting their DVDs or going to see you live. Like, I saw you at Mickey's for Cocktails with the Stars. You were one of the first porn stars I ever met. That was the only way that we could interact with adult stars at that time. So how did you know that your star was on the rise?
Yeah, it was so different back then. I mean, it's like comparable to the 1950s when they had, like, the, you know, just like six channels, and everybody watched the same show, and everybody knew who this star was, and they could talk about the episode. And that's how it was when I started. And then, you know, once social media came out and fan sites, especially, that's out the window. So back then, when the big, like, 12 porn companies, gay studios ran everything, you know, you'd get recognized all the time, you know, the top of the Space Needle in Seattle, on a bus at the grocery store, on an airplane. I was telling him a story earlier about that. But now people see too many faces throughout the day. They can't pinpoint who you are unless you're behind them on a billboard. So now it's not as much as it used to be.
Because we're seeing faces in real life, but then we're also scrolling past 1,000 faces a day.
Yeah, exactly. So it's different. I mean, there's pros and cons, because now you can control what you put out yourself personally and interaction with your fans. It's a lot more work than back then. I mean, back then I'd work like one day a month. Now it's like
I've heard that.
30 days a month.
Yeah, because you're filming your own content, you're having to edit that content, then you're being flown around, like you're flying off to Miami and then flying back home and then flying off somewhere else.
Yeah.
Like in a matter of a few days.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, I like it. You know, I'm a workhorse at heart, and, you know, very entrepreneurial mindset. So it's like I love it, and I like doing the marketing and interaction with the fans and talking with them and being able to have more control and say over what it is, because before they just put out whatever they wanted, whatever they thought was best for the company, and you didn't have any say in it.
When they used you guys, they put you guys in calendars, they had sex toys, they had all this stuff. It's not like the money ever dribbled down to you.
No. Yeah, I mean, yeah, there is no AAG, Adult Actors Guild, which maybe we should start.
Now, do we have big porn stars the way that we used to, like in the 80s and the 90s?
Only a few, you know, a few tall poppies in that field. Like, right, I'm sitting.
Wow, look at Mr. Four-time nominee Gavia. Look at him go. Long hair to.
No, I lost them all. I'm totally humbled. I'm like, I'm nothing. Continue.
Yeah, I'm sitting next to him.
Yeah.
Well, you have, well, I think male side, very little. You got Angela White on, like, the straight side, Amaranth. And I interviewed Angela White on the red carpet, and my wife loves her. She's, like, such a fangirl. But on the guys, Johnny Sins for the straight side, gay side.
Yeah, Johnny Sins, I know that name.
I don't think there's anybody that just jumps up on the gay side anymore. That's just massive.
But I mean, even as a kid, before I, like, grew up and knew what porn was, I knew the name Jenna Jameson because she was such an empire of her time. I just don't see that happening. Is it because there's too many porn stars, or because we're becoming too familiar with these porn stars?
Too many. Too many, yeah. I mean, you went from a handful to 10,000. I mean, there's millions, literally. There's millions of people. Before, you had a few companies marketing, and now everybody's their own marketer. So you have just hundreds of thousands of...
Do you think the length of careers is changing, that your people spending less time in the industry?
That's interesting. So before, the companies controlled it. So when you got a little old, they kick you out, and you had nowhere to go. But now I have, like, friends that, females that are, you know, 40, 45, jumping in at that age, And they're pulling 30K a month on OnlyFans.
That's insane.
Because the fans are paying for what they want. Yeah. It's not the studio who thinks that's what it should be.
And the studio will make a woman a MILF like at 26. And like she's like MILF of the year. It's like, but she's 26.
Yeah, when they hire at like 18, like basically MILF.
Yeah.
To them, yeah.
But for the gay guy side, people come and go. Like, we'll have somebody famous. It's like, oh yeah, what happened to them? And then they're gone. Is that because people don't want to make a career of it, or they get what they want and then they disappear?
You were pushed out before, but now if you don't want to be pushed out, you don't have to be pushed out because you just push through marketing. And I mean, back in 2010, when it switched from websites to live camming, they're like, go live cam, make us, this is the new thing. So we got kicked out of the studios. Everybody's sitting at home waiting for a ding, and then go like this, ding, and then fucking dance monkey. I mean, I hated it.
I just don't want people to see my room. Like, that would be weird to me. I'm like, I have to clean and vacuum. Like, what? No.
Yeah.
I think some people too, though, only do it to like support a career, or like they're going to education.
Yeah, and then yeah.
Yeah, but also I think maybe, I don't know. It is a little bit intense on your mental state sometimes doing this career, and the longevity of what that does to your brain. I don't know, but you know,
I watched your recent YouTube video where you're talking a little bit about it.
Forgot my YouTube channel.
I did my research
too.
You
do, yeah. Both of you. Oh my
God. Is it in your case? Is it something that like you are hoping to, like, you just released an album? Are you hoping to branch out into other endeavors, or is it something that like you see yourself doing for quite some time?
That's a great question. I feel like, artsy background preceding porn, I always thought like porn is not the dead end goal. It's always like a stepping stone to something else. Mm. Like, build this name as Nick Floyd, and then have that audience see your creative side other places. Mm-hmm. So I always was like, maybe music, but I always thought paintings and fine art world would be like my thing. But like, you're not 45 with like a tortured past. It's like, we don't really want you. So it's really tough to get into that. And music is like, anyone can release music. So.
And I've heard that content creators, adult content creators, you know, they'll put a shirtless selfie on Instagram or something, and all the fans will like it, comment. You put something that's dear to your heart, such as music or something that you painted, whatever, and it's like, hello?
Are they in the room with us?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, it's crazy.
So that has to be frustrating, too. It's not that they're not, like, appreciating it, but they just don't interact it the same way as, like, an underwear pic.
Yeah. Like, you built this audience to, like, this. Like, now you're posting this. It's a little bit of a switch, but if you do something like a similar vein, like erotic art or maybe like club fashion, they could be like, oh, I actually do like this. Mm-hmm. So you have to like be smart about it, I guess.
Yeah. Okay, our first hot topic of tonight, we all weigh in. Like I said, we get weird messages sent to us for advice. Like, I'm the best one to give advice. I don't think so. This one, I saw my friend's boyfriend on Grindr. They're supposed to have a closed relationship. Should I tell him?
Mm-hmm. Who are you closer to with?
Well, he says my friend's boyfriend, so not like my other friend.
Like, are they closer to the boyfriend cheating, or the one that's like?
No, I think he's closer to the boyfriend, not the boyfriend's. Mm. No, not the friend's boyfriend. No, sorry. Yes.
Closer to his friend.
My
not
God,
the
I don't even know what I'm saying. I'm so sorry. We're messing up your advice. I'm not gonna jump off a cliff. Like, what? So no, he's closer to his friend, and he saw the friend's boyfriend on, but they have a closed relationship.
I think I'd message the boyfriend and be like, hey, did something change? Am I missing something? Talk to them first. And then at least when you talk, if you talk to your friend, you can like, then you have even more information to share. Yeah. Like, they lied to me, they're lying to you.
I like
or
that.
If they say like, no, it's good, things have changed, then it's none of my damn
business.
But
what if he's lying?
And I don't, right.
He's not going to admit, no, I'm cheating.
But then when you talk to your friend, you got even more information to share.
And then they're out.
Ooh. Yeah.
They're out. Yeah. Okay.
Starting
all right.
Casual like that too. Yeah. Being like, just letting you know, like, is it changed? Yeah. Not like he's cheating.
Right.
Like,
just like talk to them.
You can even joke, be like, hey, I see you, and see what they say.
It's always better to have more information.
Look at you, girl. Yes.
Yeah.
What do you
think?
Oh, I'd like to tell the boyfriend, so this is going to cost you.
A night at Panda Express. I love how that's my idea of a great date. my life. Okay.
part of the question was, we were asking if you had wanted to make this part of your life, because I know we had a conversation. It's like, you know, this could be a stepping stone for your art. At what point do you think you would say no to being in the industry?
I think about that like every day. Like, if some opportunity came to me, I'd be like, end all the contracts tomorrow, you know. But I do love what I do. I'm just at a point, me 2 years in, and you're like a full professional. Like, oh, I'm so like aged in this community. Like, no, shut the hell up. But, you know, I always think, I don't know, there could be something more fulfilling. And it's just like a part, not a part time, it's just like a job right now. Mm. It's not like fulfilling my soul.
But it looks like you enjoy it.
Well, parts of me enjoy
it. Or is that
it.
Just the acting?
Yeah.
Oh, it's just the acting?
One head enjoys it.
What? You mean what we did the other day wasn't real?
That was real, baby. Mind, heart, and soul. That was all me.
Now, Reese, I know that you left the industry for a couple of years and then you came back. What made you leave and what made you come back?
Yeah, well, you know, like I said, we went to live camming and it wasn't jiving with me so much. And I didn't live locally, so I had to live cam. And I wanted to get back into, or wanted to get into the acting in the mainstream. So I opened up a cupcake shop with my family, hoping that would pay for independent films.
You brought the cakes to the bakery?
Yeah.
Wah, wah. Okay, never mind.
Yeah, the juicy fat.
How do you go from like filming porn to like selling cupcakes?
Well, my sisters, they worked at Dutch Brothers for like 10 years.
Oh, okay.
So they knew how to make coffee, and they're twins. So we called it Twinsies, and it had coffee and cupcakes.
So cute.
And, you know, it went good for a little bit, but there was, you know, a little bit of business rival with some of their old bosses, and ultimately we shut it down. But we got some accolades, some awards for some of the best cupcakes in our local town. Yeah. But I want to get back into acting, and I was actually just got myself a 17-hour job. And right after I started it, VH1 got a hold of me, and then they wanted to come after I started a month, and I'm sitting there tired, brain dead from working 17-hour days that first month of opening it. And then they come in filming shit all over the place. It was crazy, dude. But so, yeah, I was away for those few years, yet my film still played. So I don't believe technically I was ever fully away.
Well, and audiences don't realize when we keep seeing new clips, it's not that they're recent. They could be from a year, 2 years. I know some people have retired and their new stuff is still coming out, like you said.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I have some people that's like they have 10 years of footage of an individual.
Yeah.
Like they have your image forever.
Well, especially during COVID, all of that stuff came out because studios had nothing else to put out.
Yeah.
Were you happy that you came back?
Oh, yeah. Because what happened was I was out here over on Santa Monica eating breakfast with my buddy Clyde. And Brian Hahn, this singer.
Girl. For those of you that remember Brian Hahn, the singer, do tell. He's been on the show before.
Oh, has he?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, I love Brian. But we were eating breakfast, and Brian's like, are you Reese Rideout? Then we started taking
like he
photos.
He didn't know. Rah, rah, rah.
And before the night was over, we were working on a song. And then we drove out. We convinced Clyde to drive us at 4 a.m. to Matador Beach.
How did you get, should I ask how you convinced him?
Yeah, because Clyde doesn't get up early. You'll meet Clyde tonight. He's the one from UK.
Okay, we'll see.
So, yeah, so Brian Hahn, he was showing me what he was doing on OnlyFans and everything. This was back like early 2017 or so, or maybe 16. And I was like, okay, let me get back into this. I can do it. Yeah, just jump back in, and the audience and the community was just so welcoming that it's like, well, why did I ever, you know, take a little break? I should have never, never took a break.
Some of the questions we got in very different ways, and I'll just answer or ask it in one way is, people want to know how the payment structure of OnlyFans works, and how much should somebody of your stature expect to make? Like, what's an average? Because I hear people making a lot of OnlyFans, but I don't know how it works. You kind of told me last time you visited. Like the structure, like a scene, doing a scene is worth more than doing like two studio pieces because of the longevity and all that kind of stuff. Can you talk about a little bit how that payment structure works? You don't have to talk about amounts, but like.
Well, I'd like to hear Nick's take on it first and then.
Oh my God. Because I started in OnlyFans and then went studio.
But oh, okay.
I think to preface, so many people lie about how much they make.
Like, I think that. I think that's so much.
That is a fact. They're like, well, I make like da 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 da, and it's totally a false, because you can kind of fact check by looking at fans and like what is it, but I think it really, if you find a niche community and you're like dedicated to what you do, you can expect like a pretty decent earning if you like stick with it, and you shouldn't expect like an overnight
it takes time
thing. But if you already have like a certain Instagram following and you're already okay with like sharing that with them, then you could maybe semi-expect that. But I think it really boils down to like consistency, how good a quality it is, and do we see like the passion in your eyes? Because I think people can really tell if it's like with your heart or like, I'm just in it to like be famous and be a god, you know, like, ew. I don't know. Like, do you ever experience that or?
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've seen it, yeah.
Yeah. Some co-hosts, or not co-hosts, scene partners.
How dare you, sir?
I think he was talking about me, don't worry.
Oh, no, yeah. Girl, you're on fire. No, but you can totally tell. And, you know, fans want to kind of experience your sex life in a very intimate way. And mm-hmm. we know if you're playing for the camera or not. And there's some big names in the industry. They only know how to do two sex moves. It's like, girl, you got to learn something else. You won performer yeah. of the year. Like,
get bump, flexible.
Bump your pussy up. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm. But like coming from studio to like OnlyFans, how was that for you?
Well, I was lucky because, I mean, if I would have started the OnlyFans just, you know, close to 40 years old in 2017 or so, it wouldn't have worked.
I don't know about that.
You're very sexy.
It would have been harder. I just lucky I had a name before I jumped in. So people already, you know, they already knew.
But I think the OnlyFans craze has made us come aware of what we really like to watch, and it's given us power. So that if your niche is the bear community, mm-hmm. there was no studio porn for you yeah. to watch that. But OnlyFans, there's a content creator there that'll do just exactly what you want to see. Or you want to watch somebody eat Panda Express all day? That's my favorite. like, there's that for you, you know? So I think...
Honey walnut shrimp. People,
orange chicken, bitch.
Oh, orange chicken.
Yeah, and they started opening at 10 a.m. now. Don't ask me how I know it. It's my hangover food so much. It's orange chicken and half fried rice, half steamed rice, because I'm healthy. But that's like my hangover meal.
Do you set a scheduled order at 3 a.m.?
How do you know? I do. It's like 11:05. Well, knock, knock, knock.
I've been there. I've been there. Yeah.
So I want to talk one more thing about OnlyFans. We're going to go next to our hot topic. OnlyFans, we know, during COVID, like, blew up. It was like the only way that content creators could film, and it's the only way that people could like interact still and not feel like isolated, because we were in your bedrooms, we were in your lives. And studios, we know, couldn't put out anything new for a while. And so OnlyFans did this. Studios freaked out and they thought, oh my God, it's the end of studios. It's the end of studio acting. It's like, that's over. But now it seems like studios are now back on the rise. And I've talked to many content creators that say that their OnlyFans income has dropped off significantly by half or more. Mm. Have you found that drop off now that studio porn is back in business?
No, I've been, you know, I mean, it ebbs and flows. I haven't seen it drop in half. I mean, I hit one of my highest months a few months ago, so it was really good. And I think this month is probably going to be even, you know, even better. It's all what you put into it. I like to say it's 1% filming and 99% marketing.
100%.
It's all about, you know, that thumbnail, what that trailer, that clip, the gets them to click and then purchase.
But I think with OnlyFans, it has to evolve. Like, we've seen people with the same people over and over in the same bedroom. Like, I know what they're reading because I'm so bored, I'm looking at their bookshelf. You know what I mean? So it's like, you guys have to mix it up. How do you mix it up? It's OnlyFans. It's not like you can go in a studio and
what I think is really set together. OnlyFans, what the fans love about it is they have the ability to actually access you. Like they didn't before with studios. You know, you had this wall, this firewall between you. But now they can directly get to you and talk to you. So when you talk with fans and text with them, I love sending like voice messages to fans. I'll be like, you know, vote for me here and I'll give you a voice message. So I there's days I'm doing like 50 voicemails to fans. You know, like, hey, Johnny, what's up? Thanks for voting.
A lot of content creators do not do that.
No, they
don't take that time. Or they'll have a manager run their account. Take and people. You know, Derek Cage is not going to be, hey, Strawberry, what's up? No, bitch.
Hey, Strawberry, yeah. What's up? What's up, Strawberry? How you doing?
So you guys constantly have
to... I like Derek Cage.
We love Derek. Yeah. But there's that pressure to keep reinventing yourself. Otherwise, it will stagnate no matter what you do.
It used to be so easy back in the day with like YouTube. You know, I'd come out with something. Like, I was eating chips. One Randy Blue, like, we were filming out in Palm Springs.
I remember.
Chip video.
I ate chips with you, bitch.
And it would just go crazy, you know, on YouTube. Or I'd put something out. You know, remember that We Fit chick? She did, like, the We Fit. Ding.
Two things I'm not into, chicks and fit. I don't know why you're asking me this.
Well, I duplicated it, and it started blasting like nuts on YouTube. But since I'm a dude, they pulled it.
this is constantly happening. This could be a whole show on its own. There's such harassment on adult content creators on Facebook, Instagram. Like if you put a certain hashtag or whatever, your profile gets shadowed or blocked or deleted. And we're talking deleted, like, you know, 100, 200,000 fans. And
no warning.
Social media is what feeds your OnlyFans. Like, that's the only way you can kind of advertise that. And that's awful. And it's an attack against the adult community. And it's even happening on a political level where certain levels or certain laws are being passed. You know, adult content is restricted now in 4 U.S. states. And a lot of people don't realize that. Utah is one of them. Texas is the other one. You have to register. You have to upload a copy of your driver's license in order to see any 18 and over content. That's insane. And people don't know that this is happening in the U.S. And it's like, I thought adult content was becoming more mainstream and more accepted. We're supposed to be in terms or in talks with our sexuality because that's how you better become educated about sex. That's how you prevent STIs or worse diseases. Like, we should be talking about sex on a bigger level.
That is an indication, though, that it is becoming more mainstream, right? Because, like, the pushback wouldn't exist if it was not bothering people, if it wasn't visible, if we weren't able to talk about it, if we weren't, like, on social media, on public platforms. So it is almost it's a sign of how much there has changed.
100%.
That there is now pushback.
Okay, it was just like
way.
Noise in the back, but now like it's a real thing. Yeah. And it's funny, Pornhub puts out their analytics. The viewers and the certain categories that are most popular are in the Bible Belt of the U.S. And those lawmakers are trying to restrict our porn watching. Mm-hmm. And certain categories, we know the trans community is under attack. Laws... The most viewed category, which is number 2 on Pornhub, is trans. And it's in those communities that are the top to restrict trans rights.
Oh, wow.
Which is so hypocritical. Okay, we just got deep a little bit. Let's go to a hot topic, shall we? This one says, I like drinking. I always want to make my first date drinking related so they know what's up. My friend said, that's a terrible first date. And that's why I'm not getting third and fourth dates. Is it?
How are you acting on alcohol, maybe? Or, like, is it an issue?
Girl.
I mean.
Girl.
What do you guys think? Bar dates good? No?
I would say morning date is, like, pretty supreme.
Morning?
Yeah, breakfast date.
Aww. Absolutely not.
So wholesome.
No. You got sleep
maybe
in your
the
eyes.
Gay community.
Your hair looks like boo-boo. What are you talking about?
Okay, maybe, like, a brunch.
I remember.
You can still have alcohol.
I remember taking a girl out on a breakfast date and absolutely ruining my chances with her because I'm better at night.
Because nobody's really on in the morning. Well, no, I guess some
you're a morning person.
Yeah, I am a morning person.
But you're
though.
Like deep and dark and goth. How is that possible? You're like goth light.
I'm just so cool like that. It's okay. No, I don't know. I think maybe when you drink too much and you're in public or in a scenario where like there's so many people and loud noises, you can't really hear the person. So maybe that was the issue.
I get that. But also a first date shouldn't be so monumental either. I never think it should
be.
Casual. It shouldn't be at the fancy restaurant. You shouldn't dress up like you don't usually dress up because you want to work into those kind of dates. So the first date should be more casual. It should be an hour or less unless it really clicks and then you do other things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I get you.
Yeah.
That's the other downside of drinking, right?
Oh,
well,
yeah.
That's also true because you wake up the next morning like, what? Who is in my bed? But I think on the first date, you should show the person who you are. That's who they're going to see in 3 months.
You're showing them you're an alcoholic. Maybe.
You said it, not me, on the rocks.
I don't know who it comes from.
You do you.
Yeah,
do you,
okay. Yeah. Reese?
First date, you know, I think what's great is if it happens naturally. You know, it's not like you set it up through some app or something. It's like, you know, you're at a communal place or a gym or... wedding or stripping on some chick and then things go from there later on in the night and then you know.
Sounds like a quality date you're going on.
Someone's gonna save that clip.
Yeah, somebody has it. Like,
repeat record.
Yeah. I have to know what happened on this breakfast date.
I was exhausted because I had been working bartending all night the night
before.
Did you
have your B. Arthur voice? Okay, so you said go on a date with a girl, and I use air quotes for straight girl. Uh-huh. You identify as pansexual.
By whatever, I like everyone.
Okay.
Almost everyone.
Okay.
Well. All holes are 98.6 degrees.
Right. Oh, my God. And if they're not, then you got issues. Okay, this is another hot topic. Should a host during a hookup provide towels and a shower, or is that expecting too much? The last two people's houses I went to didn't provide that, and they looked shocked when I asked to take a shower. I actually have thoughts about this because I have thoughts.
Okay.
I want to hear what you guys have to say first.
would say definitely you need towels. Yeah, I mean even
towels
even,
I can see.
Even if the towel's dirty, just kind of shake it off and fold.
Did I just do that?
Well, you're gonna get it dirty anyways.
I'm not gonna use a dirty towel. Would you use a dirty towel?
It depends. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I have. Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely. Being in the porn industry, I mean, you got cum all over your face and shit. You know, people go home without showering sometimes. Yeah,
but those aren't porn stars. They could be like dirty ass towels.
Yeah.
Like mold.
Yeah. But our cum is super clean, and I can prove it. I have the tests.
Yeah. 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 Sure. Okay, but how about a shower? Should they expect to take a shower at your house?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it'd be nice to have everything ready. Okay. I totally would. I'd clean up the bathroom and I'd have things ready.
Nick,
I would say I never expect it because like. I don't know, like, I never, yeah. Like, porn has always, not always, like, sometimes sent me home, like, sticky and, like, weird.
But I'm not talking about porn, I'm talking about, like,
that
a personal
has made me feel like I never expect it in real life. So, whenever they do offer it, I'm like, oh my god, thank you so much. Like, this is luxury service.
Okay.
But maybe I just have low standards for myself for, like, what hookups offer me.
You were pretty happy the other day when I put a clean towel on the in the bathroom for you.
Why is that
a surprise? And he's like,
the
oh.
clean towel thing? There's no negotiation on that.
But Alexander's the one that washed them. And then then I folded it and put it back.
I do what I can to support the community. Yeah.
You do, yeah.
Yeah.
And the folding of it, I was like, bitch, this is Hilton. This is amazing. I don't know.
I even washed more towels yesterday. So
yes,
I did. I have a full load of clean towels ready for people.
Yes.
So come on over.
Yeah.
I'm interested in your thoughts, but I honestly, I can't think of like any time anyone's really offered me a shower.
Oh my God.
Like if it's a, you know, a quick in and out situation.
See, that's kind of what
I'm usually also the one who's ready to get the fuck out of there.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's what it's like. I don't want to take a shower in your shower. I'll go home and take a shower. Yeah.
If it's, you know, if it's someone that you have like a relationship with or like there's a standing, like more of a rapport, that's one thing. Most of the time I'm the one who's like, I'm done. I'll shower at home.
Like, plus, yeah. I feel weird taking a shower in a stranger's house because like, what if they're like psycho or something? And then, you know, it's like,
Yeah.
I don't want to be in a stranger's house anymore than I have to.
Do you want
to
take
on
a
the
shower?
Other hand, if you're like already being intimate with someone, like, and you've like shared that experience and shared like physicality, then like there should be enough respect to be like, yeah, you can shower. Like,
if there's like cuddling involved or you watch a movie.
But I just like, if you're gonna fuck, then like hygiene should be a thing that you're both agreeing on, right? So
but you come prepared with hygiene,
right
I don't understand about
well, it depends.
Come
if it's a morning
a
date and you gotta be somewhere, then maybe you need to take a shower.
Like
that's
to
true.
Work
yeah
but it also who has the cum on them. Did they come in you? Did they come on you? Did
I,
they
I
come on themselves?
It matters.
Did they pull out and accidentally hit themselves in the face?
Right.
You know?
That's still a towel. I mean.
So are you sticky right now?
Yeah.
Girl, please. It's from Orange Chicken.
So what are your thoughts?
No, I like I said, I don't want to be in a stranger's house any more than I have to. I feel weird when somebody wants to like hang out more than what we talked about.
You're having sex with strangers, Alexander?
No, I mean.
Uh-oh, we caught him. We caught him.
But you know, it's also the hookup that wants to come over and small talk before. It's like, that's not what, it's not Tinder, you know? Mm. Okay, anyway.
Also like a hot take, don't join me. Like,
oh, yeah. Yes.
I don't want
They
want
to continue to get, yes. Yeah, see, that. But it leaves it, you're susceptible to them.
I
or
know.
They could go through your
like,
wallet
well,
or take your clothes.
Stranger sex is the best, though.
Stranger danger. Okay, we need to talk about AI in the adult industry. We got this question from other people in the industry, by the way. All of a sudden, I've been seeing AI-generated, hot, very homoerotic pictures of Henry Cavill, Chris Hemsworth, Jason Momoa, Tom Holland. Have you guys seen these?
Yes.
I showed you them this morning, Reese. They're totally fabricated.
Yeah,
they look so close to real. You have to do a double take, and then you still take a third take, and you're like, wow. I can't imagine what they have to say, even though they're allies to the community, but it's like, that's not them. Reese, you kind of are serving as a pioneer when it comes to AI adult content, and we're not talking about face swap or something. We're talking about a full AI boyfriend experience, and I'll just explain very quickly. You work with an AI company that meets with you. They profile you. They get to know your personality. Tony, can you show one of the pictures? It's you on a unicorn. There's also two more AI pics, so that you can kind of tell that it's not. No, well.
Yeah, it's entertainment, you know.
But other
it's
than
a lot
the unicorn,
fun.
I would think that the other part of you is real.
It's so good, it really is, and you can talk to me, you can have it create any photo you want. I mean, whether I'm on a dolphin, a unicorn, underwater.
We played with the other day. We're like, put him in like a loincloth and like a golden laurel.
Hercules.
Yeah, Hercules. Yeah, yeah. And you got it. Or we can put you in rubber. Tony, I think there's a few other of the AI picks if you can pick them from the regular ones.
I'm just so happy. So it's Siren AI is the company. Siren AI.
Was that like Sweet Dreams with Nick or with Reese?
Yeah, I was just telling my fans goodnight. So I told AI, you know, I wanted Reese in a crescent moon, you know, at nighttime with a nightcap on. And that's what came out. And you know, it creates in just less than a couple minutes. It's just amazing stuff. I mean, I'm just so excited for it.
And here's what the company promises too. Like, I could text you, and I could text flirty, sexy, erotic talk, but I could also tell you, hey, I'm lonely. Can you provide me companionship?
Oh yeah, there's been people that are on there. It's completely platonic. And have been talking to some of the AI models, like Roman Todd. Myself, there's a couple others.
Tyler, I forget what his last name is.
Yeah. Taylor.
Taylor, yep.
Right, yeah, and then Jewel. She's another one. Jewel Diamant. But, yeah, Siren AI, and if you're a model and you go there, tell them I sent you. It's just my voice. It is me. It is, you know what I did the other day?
You could be saying anything. You could say, hey, read me the menu from, you know, Del Taco, and you'll do it.
Oh, yeah. I was cleaning some white sneakers, and I was like, how do I do this? And I'm going, let me go ask myself. And then I go, hey, Reese, how do I clean white sneakers? He goes, okay, Nick, what you going to do? So you're going to grab a toothbrush. You're going to get some white vinegar.
Okay, so I have some devil's advocate, and we got some messages from some people in the industry who are not happy about this. There's a thought that AI is going to take over the adult biz. Is that a possibility?
Well, I hope it does.
That'll put you out of a job.
But I'm in the forefront of it.
But they're making Henry Cavill kiss Chris Hemsworth for free.
I think it's gonna allow people to be more creative. And be able to create stuff faster. Now you know how like so social media and just for fans, the fan sites, OnlyFans, all that stuff has kind of pushed the entire adult industry as it was before, how it used to operate, out. This might now change things again. It's gonna create like 10 times more. This might create 100 more times content. You just think anybody can just type? And did you see the new Sora? The new Sora AI, like, you just type a few sentences and it gives you like beautiful videos that you think, it's crazy.
That's not scaring anybody. We don't need Steven Spielberg now. We don't need a scriptwriter. That doesn't scare anybody.
Well, then you're going to need marketing, and you're going to need an engine behind you to push your film, because anybody can. Soon you'll be able to make a film from a few
paragraphs. But your talent is taken out.
Well, what's up, Addie?
I'm curious to know, because I would assume it's already like you're maybe more. Exposed or vulnerable than like your average person on social media with like images of you, videos of you, both of you, which can be, I mean, it's amazing, congrats, but can also be probably scary at times because you do lose control. Like you were saying, people taking clips and sending them back to you, if you're acting, you do lose some control over your image. Is there any concern that like with AI or even just like having performances recorded that like other people could use your content to generate something that you don't want to be associated with, or that say your virtual experience might say something that is not in keeping with what you would do or say?
Well, that's a very good
and
point.
How much control do you get to exert over that, and is it scary?
Well, and also, why should a studio pay for you to do a scene when they can program you into the computer?
Yeah, I mean, it's,
that scares me, you guys.
No, but then you have the same, you know, even playing field. You could do the same.
Right. How do you feel about it?
No, I feel like...
And you being an artist as well.
No, I was going to say, like, the overall AI to incorporate into the whole world, it's pretty an overall, like, negative. Only because, like, the humanity of it all, the human touch, it's so worthless now. It's so, like, okay, well, I don't have to, like, do anything now. Or I think maybe the money is going to all be funneled into, like, a couple individuals, not, like... Maybe like
at
everyone at the forefront.
I'm gonna hang with you, Reese. Yeah.
No, but
it's gonna be like Terminator world with the adult industry. It's like we're gonna have robots doing all the porn.
Yeah, and I don't know. I think, well, it's on like a super high incline, like 0 to 100 in the past couple years. So I don't even know where it's gonna be in the future.
It has developed so quickly.
And I'm like,
And I've tested AI writing because, you know, I write in addition to doing this, and it'll capture my personality. It'll capture some of my sass. That's going to put me out of a job. I work for two magazines.
Well, we're not going to be able to stop it. So we have to figure out how to kind of work with it. It's kind of like when the Model T took over the horse and buggy, and there were some people going, damn cars.
Even the
look
web,
at us now.
The web and email. People complain when email. This says email's never going to last because nobody should be available all the time. Well, now look at us and email.
Yeah, so
you didn't send me an email in an hour. I'm like, where are you, Addie?
Yeah,
okay,
so
you didn't text me back today.
Oh, you did. Oh.
Oh, you can work it out. Go ahead. Ding, ding.
Here's also some other people from the industry commented on this AI. And I think part of it might be jealous that you are at the forefront of this, that you're one of the first, like, and it's been working well.
Yeah.
It's also, AI is also giving false expectations to body-wise. And we know part of mental health, which is, Nick, what you were talking about, we're just now talking about mental health in the adult industry. Big part of mental health in the gay community, in any community, is body image and body issues. AI is putting these impossible bodies together. The proportions are ridiculous, but they're ridiculously hot because we fantasize about bubble butts and big bulges and all that. And so it's going to put you guys in a different, you guys are going to have to compete with these AI bodies. That's going to take you totally out of it. And it's going to cause a lot of anguish when we're talking about body image. Plus, if I'm watching AI porn and then I watch studio porn, I'm like, wait, these bodies don't look the same. I'm not into that anymore. Then that goes that.
But here's the thing, you know, it's like the, if you go into the gym and you see some hot guy and you look at him.
Go where?
Address
inside of gym.
Oh yeah, gym bar. I love gym bar.
But you know, you see some hot guy with muscles, and he's not going to help you work out. He's going to slap you, call you bitch. But if you
Where?
If you
sign me up,
he's getting excited. Yeah. You're missing the point, Alexander.
Sorry. Okay.
But if you asked AI, like, look, I want to look like this. How can I? And it will help you, and it'll tell you where to work out, when, how to work
16
out.
16 abs. They can let you know how to do that.
Well, that's just...
You get a BBL in 2 days?
They'll work on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can. You know, I can give you the exercises. I know them. Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's an interesting dovetail with something my friend was asking me earlier. I told him I was going to be on the podcast. I was like, is there anything I should ask these guys? And they were at the Tom of Finland house earlier, like at a show. Yeah.
That's
and
actually
so,
really good.
And especially as like an illustrator, maybe you can speak to that. We've always had some ways to like create on fantasies, so...
That's a really good point. Tom and Finland, we know, are so hyper-exaggerated versions of guys that really don't exist.
Yeah. Well, I think he was such like a special a really artist, point. And like he was like solely producing it at his own pace, and it wasn't like hyper-realistic renderings of anyone you ever wanted. It was like the biker or the cop. But it is the same vein of like unrealistic, like 2 feet long, whatever, you know? And we obviously know that's like not real, but... I think when
it's still fantasy.
When it spreads to like Instagram and like the modern eye, it's so much more like hurtful, because like we were like, that was the shameful art category of Poland and then like the leather community in America.
Yeah, that's a really good point.
Now it's like everywhere, so it's more to everyone. They take it in the wrong way and take it in the good way, where it's like, oh, I love this Instagram page. I love Cody, who doesn't exist, but he's my AA boyfriend. But there's also like, I also hate myself, and you know, I'm never going to look like that.
Yeah.
But also even the creator side of like, well, I have to compete with that. It's so, that's, you know.
And also when somebody can text you all the time, Reese, how afraid are you guys? Because you guys do message your fans, you do live appearances. It kind of breaks even that barrier when somebody can text you at all times. Are you afraid of like psycho fans coming out of the woodwork?
Or have you had one?
Besides me?
Well, yeah, they're out there. But, you know, I take everything with a stride and with a light heart and grain of salt, and so I have fun with it, with everybody that comes around. There's nobody ever gets too crazy, but it could happen.
What's with, like, you didn't text me back, or like your AI says something wrong? You know,
it's down.
You're like, I don't remember.
I'm coming to your house. Why is it down?
Yeah, that's creepy too.
That's very creepy.
Okay, we're gonna do 2 quick hot topics, and then our final adult content topic is a very hot topic on both sides of the fence, and that's gay for pay. So get ready for that. Okay, this one, talking about body image. My partner gained 30 pounds during COVID, and it doesn't show any signs he's wanting to get rid of it.
Semaglutide.
I have comments about that. I know Anthony has comments about that too. I'm just not as attracted to him in the bedroom anymore. Am I allowed to say something?
I think always being open and honest is the best choice, and to like find a common...
That's a sensitive subject, though.
No, it is, and I think if you're with someone, you should be able to like talk about that. If you're not, then I think that's a bigger issue in the relationship.
Yeah, well, that's a good point.
Yeah, I agree. And you should give someone a heads up before you just like run.
Yeah, not just like, well, you're fat, I'm breaking up with
yeah.
you.
Yeah, like you that's sh- an issue. Like, it could be too. A horrible conversation, but if you don't have the conversation, that's probably worse, right?
Oh, he's suffering and silent. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is somebody okay? Let's do another version of this. Is somebody gaining 30 pounds? Is that a relationship breaker?
Depends on the person, maybe.
Mm. They might like be, Danny like, DeVito, older. 30 pounds. Of,
it depends. Are you in this relationship with this person just for sex and just for physical attraction? Is that what you want out of a relationship? Mm. Because if like there's other components and none of those have changed, then...
The language is my partner, which tends me makes me believe it's a longer term.
Well, I would think that would be really sad if that would like change everything about a relationship.
Yeah, you know, I would say, you know, motivate them. Get them moving, happy about themselves. Show them how they can be better, and meanwhile, just think of somebody else while you fuck them.
Oh my god,
that's a life hack.
Is that your AI talking, or is that you talking?
You'll get there.
Okay, yeah. All right.
You'll get through it.
I mean, yeah. I mean, I think really just the communication part, but also maybe, you know, if that's the only thing like making them attracted to you. You could also like try something else in the bedroom, maybe, where it's like, maybe your rock hard abs and perfect body was like all I wanted, and now you kind of have like a more heavy set body. Maybe we can try something else, like a toy experience, or maybe like role play, anything to make it more like fantasy.
Or a paper bag.
Blindfold. No, I don't.
It sounds like we're talking about like a garbage bag, not a paper bag.
Or you can get an AI boyfriend.
Hey. You know,
and we know after a few years in a relationship, the sex kind of goes away. So if like it's really the next one we got, this one's interesting. It kind of is along the same lines, but it's not. My partner started wearing lace panties and feminine lingerie. I don't think it's sexy at all. Can I tell him no?
Yeah,
this is almost a body issue, but it's in a whole different arena. It's more, is this a fetish?
It depends if he like, are they wearing them just like when they get dressed to go to work in the morning? Because then that's up to them.
If it's in a bedroom, then that's a different thing, and feminine thing, right? Lingerie. Lace panties sounds like 9 to 5, and then lingerie sounds like nighttime fun.
What do you think, Reese?
You know, if somebody likes something, I mean, it'd be hard to tell somebody not to like it.
We're talking about underwear. Like, we're not talking like, you know, they want to clip your toenails with their teeth. No. Thank you.
Good example. You know,
just for our news this week, Ricky Martin came out as a big foot fetish person. Did you know that? He told GQ that.
Wow.
He has a huge foot fetish, apparently, and he's not ashamed to.
Hold on. Let me tell my team to get hold of him really quick.
Yeah. Ricky Martin feet AI? Yeah. I've never been into
feet.
Is that
feet. The final segment? Everyone
I'll wear socks in the
off.
Shower. Yeah. I wear socks in the shower. Like, I can't say feet.
That's demonic.
You could probably start an OnlyFans.
Because I'm goth and emo.
Oh.
Yeah, so I won't do breakfast vibe. Dates. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay, so lingerie in the bedroom. I mean, it's underwear. We're not talking about, like...
Well, no one can tell anyone no, right? It'd be, again, like a conversation.
But if that's their concern, that's problematic, too. Like, you care what other people have to think over your partner? Also, if it's underwear, you just take it off and, oh, that's great, and throw it away.
Yeah, I mean... Do they want to keep it on the whole time? Or is it, like, just, like, a before? Yeah.
That's a good question.
Cause, and then it like shouldn't matter. You'd be like, well, okay, great. Like, let's just like
as long as you take it off, forget it.
Yeah.
I think if you like desensitized them slowly into it, that'd be better. Like you put some little lace on your toe, and then something on your ankle. Then you slowly
sex
like
tips
a
from Reese right out.
Your a knee brace that's lacy, and then before they know it, they don't even notice you're wearing lacy panties, and they're into it too.
Just put a doily.
Thing plant the seed.
Whole body.
Yeah.
What I would do, maybe they're more attracted to like the textures and the sensation on their skin. So I would introduce them. I'd buy them like a hot pair of like rubber, rough skin, cell block underwear, or move it that way, or like sheer without being lingerie.
Yeah, I was reading it as maybe like someone's expressing with like maybe a more feminine, like stylistic choice.
Thing.
It was what the impression I was getting. So if that's something that's like you're experiencing and want to express, then like it's definitely something you're gonna want to communicate with your partner. Because well, that's speaking to a lot about how you feel about yourself and maybe how you feel about your like sex life, I would think.
That's a long journey to go down.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. And that's indicative of, you know, I know people have broken up because people have chosen different sides to express themselves.
Yeah. But yeah, I like the mesh recommendation. Split the difference.
Yeah, but you're right. This could be like a longer term. This could be the first step of even transitioning. Yeah. Okay, our final hot topic is, and it's still a hot topic, is gay for pay. Reese, people know you are married to a woman. Long-term relationship. It's not news. Even Chelsea Handler talked about you on her show. Everyone wants to know, how does that even work? A straight man with 20 years in gay porn. And there's the other side of it where it's not working for a gay porn star who's doing straight. And that's Derek Cage, who we were talking about. Very well known. He went on this Europe tour with this girl. They filmed a bunch of scenes together. And his fans came after him violently on X, formerly Twitter, saying that he was gay baiting. And their verbiage was pretty bad. And you're on the other side of it. It hasn't affected your career. We've all known.
Well, like when I first started, that was the hot thing, was gay for pay. So that's how they would market it. That's how RandyBlue.com marketed it, was gay for pay. That's was their audience. But then you get, you know, people saying it's not right to have somebody who's straight acting as if they're gay. Well, okay, so if I have something up my butt, you know, like to get me off, I pretend like I'm a female getting fucked. If you have something up your butt,
once a year, Reese, once a year.
Hey, I did twice this week, Alexander. Fucking
that's
twice.
Why he's walking like this.
I did, as a matter of fact, I did a bi scene for Why Not Bi on Sunday down in San Diego, and first time ever fucking a girl and getting fucked and came on camera. You should see it. It's a good shot too. My prostate was all vibrated from that cock. And then yesterday too.
Okay, so I'm just gonna be very honest because we're very honest on the show. I don't need to see my favorite gay porn star do that. Does that make me transphobic? Does it make me biphobic when I don't want to see that content of yours?
Oh, bi content?
Bi, trans content. I don't want to see that because I like to see you just do what I like you to see.
Sure, everybody likes what they like. Yeah. Yeah. No, yeah. Just then you just don't watch it. I mean, like I'm. What's funny is, you know, I'll edit my porns, right? Like when I edit my straight porns, it's like, then I have to switch over to editing my gay. I'm like, then edit the straight. Or when I'm jacking off, you know, they'll throw something else in front of you. You're like, there's no watching that.
What I do love is that we're talking about other forms of porn. It's not just gay and straight. Absolutely love that. But like when men.com put up the first bi scene, it was with Sylvia Sage. They had to take it down in a few days because the fans came out so much. Your fans haven't come after you like that, but they've come after people like Derek Cage for doing the opposite. Like, that's just a weird dichotomy.
Yeah, I mean, everybody's different. I mean, I guess it's how you interact too with the fans and how you respond to what their comments are. I'm always nice about it. I could see him being a little sassy, you know, being like, I'm the best at fucking women, so you should, and men, so fuck, I just.
Derek Cage is a little sassy, even with that deep voice. Mm.
Well, yeah.
But the climate has changed, such as, let's bring it to mainstream Hollywood. We love when Stanley Tucci plays a gay guy. We loved him in Devil Wears Prada, his romance film with Colin Firth. So have times changed, and should we be giving the gay adult film star roles to gay men? Because, like you said, there's so many stars out there. Should we be transferring that?
Was Christian Bale an actual murderer? In Psycho, or
I've
I
seen
mean,
you murder
American,
an ass, but
American,
not like that.
Was it American Psycho?
American Psycho.
Yeah. So what? We need a real murderer to play this part. You're not a real murderer.
No, we're also talking about representation from the LGBTQ community, which is a very hot topic.
But they might not be able to come out. Maybe I am gay, fully gay. Maybe I'm fully gay.
Girl, I've seen you debone a steak from across the room. There is no way that you're gay because we'd be like this.
So we've been talking about the difference between like studios and like OnlyFans and. We live in the age of the personal brand, right? Like,
yeah.
I'm assuming that's how you kind of got your start, was like choosing to build a brand for yourself. Mm. So while like representation is a good question, we're also in a decentralized market where people are building their own brands. And so you can, if you don't want to watch it, to his point, you don't have to watch it. But also it seems like creators have a lot more agency now. Mm. I don't know if you guys agree with that or not.
No, and that is a great point. I also don't like the narrative that if I don't want to watch bi porn, it makes me biphobic, or I don't support the bi community or the trans community. It has nothing to do with it. It's just what I respond to and mm-hmm. what like I built my fandom on you with.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but also porn in an overall sense is a fantasy career. We're all like suspending
disbelief. Well, that's true,
disbelief.
Too. Yes.
So it's like we're all suspending disbelief that, like, this is my stepdad and this is my whatever.
That gets creepy to me. And it's become such...
That's incesty real quick. But
like, that popularity of that kind of porn, it's like, what's happening out there?
Yeah. So I think we have to take...
I never had a stepdad. Does that happen?
Me neither.
Would you like one?
Oh, my God, girl. God, girl. Please.
But ultimately, look, I have some gay in me. How much gay do you want, guys? What? How much? Do you want 1,000%? I mean, I have some in me. Give me a break. Okay. Cut me some slack.
But, Reese, the biggest question we got is how does this really work at home? And I know I know your wife, so friendly, so supportive of your career. She actually helps you, like, organize some of your, like, she acts like as your at-home manager. How does that work at home with the marriage?
It's been years, you know, a progression of things like slow, you know, working into it. Desensitization. So yeah, it's been a long process, but she's great, and things are even better now that she's gone to the Gavians with me and and AVNs as well, and sees the glitz and glamour and the appreciation that these companies and the fans have. It makes it bigger than what it was before.
Did you start that relationship post or pre porn career?
Pre, yeah.
So, like, it was like a gradual, like, I might want to be into this, and you introduced it to her.
Yeah, yeah, from the beginning. I actually had to hide the straight porn from her back in the day.
Because there's jealousy issues there, because she knows that you're not gay, so you with a man is not as threatening as you filming with a female.
Yeah, 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 but, I mean...
I'm guessing. I don't know.
Yeah, that's true, exactly. But, like, recently, you know, I have to film more stuff lately, so I'm having... And having to bottom, like, this weekend, I had to, like, work my asshole up with, like, a dildo. And she's like, what are you doing? I'm like,
working.
Infrared dildo. She's like, yeah. So, you know, even she still has questions. You know, how gay are you? You know? But she still loves me, and it's all good. You know, we're fine.
But I think dating anybody in being a porn star, dating anybody is going to have that kind of jealousy. Nick, are you dating? Are you single? Like, what's happening?
Hell nah. It's so dead for me. Like, well, I mean, I was dating before porn, maybe, like, casual. Like, I worked at a gas station, dated my coworker. When you're talking about coworkers.
I don't know where this conversation's going. What?
No, I'm just saying, like, before.
Fill her up?
No, yeah, it was my coworker, and it was, like, so lovely until someone got stabbed in the parking lot, and it was, like, a long story. But nowadays, it's...
You're leaving this story for now?
Wow.
We have to wrap up your story.
Hey, bring me on again. No, I'm just kidding. This is my goal all along. No.
So a coworker at the gas station.
I dated, yeah. But someone in the parking lot just, unfortunately, you know, had a thing. And he's totally fine. He's alive. But nowadays, it seems to be like... I've got a lot of comments like, you've ruined your innocence. You're so not a cute boy anymore. You're just like this, like, blown out twink that...
Oh my God!
So it changed for me. Like,
everybody's having sex and everybody's watching porn. So, like,
yeah, and I'm just the one making it, so it's not a big deal. But I respect it's not a normal job, so I totally have compassion for the people who don't want to date me. So I've just been trying to, like, focus on work. But I think everyone is deserving of love, and, you know, we should all, like,
of course.
And dating other stars, like, I don't want to do that. That is so, like, if you break up, they, like, wreck your name, and I don't want anything in that realm. So it's hard to find that in between of, like, you like porn, but you're also not in it, you know.
I'm going to be honest. I've interviewed many couples in the industry, and I was like, this is the one, this is my love, and I'm just like, just don't go public with it because and it 100% has never, you don't have, like, the 40-year-old wedding anniversary with two porn stars. You just don't. Cool. What's happening?
I've gone through similar things. Like, I've worked 10 years bartending, like, and I've always dated engineers. It doesn't work. The schedules
the time
don't work.
Schedules don't
the lifestyle
work.
Doesn't work.
Yeah. And do they get jealous of all the attention you get from customers?
It's tough. Yeah. Yeah.
Really?
So it's not quite the same, but I have some, like, glimpse into it.
Well, you should see what she
dating
wears.
Is hard.
You should see what she wears to work, though.
This is my uniform. You
know, I even, like, told you the other day, because I was a little, and I was like, oh. Is that a booty I see?
You said one of the nicest things that anyone's ever said to me.
Was it inappropriate? Don't sue me.
It was. Oh. No, you said, I wish you had a dick.
I wish you had
and
a
I
dick.
And I thought, thank you.
I didn't say that. Yeah, oh, my God.
You know?
It was
I love
very
going
nice
to Nikki's.
You.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. We're going to end the show. I want to share with the audience a little bit of your artistic side. Reese, you made, like, a really fun parody video. It's on YouTube. It's called Cuz Only Fans, and I want to look at the lyrics of it. You changed, for those of us that remember, what was the movie called?
Earth Girls Are Easy.
Yeah, one of Jeff Goldblum's and Jim Carrey's first films. Yeah. And Julie Brown, who's a comedian. Julie Brown has done the show a few times.
No way.
What the fuck? this is a parody of her song, so it's going to the 80s. I want everybody to listen to the lyrics. Let's take a listen to Cuz Only Fans.
Yeah, that's AI.
There's the AI, right there. That's you on a dolphin.
Yeah, baby. Happy dolphin.
You look so real.
Because only fans, I don't have to think. I talk like a baby and I never pay for drinks. Don't have to worry about a 9 to 5. If I stay on OnlyFans, I bounce my pecs. Cause only fans, yeah. Cause only fans,
yeah.
See people working, it just makes me giggle. Cause I don't have to work, I just have to jiggle. Cause only fans, OLYNS. Cause only fans, don't you wish you were me? I never learned to work and I never learned to cook. Why should I bother when I look like I look? I know lots of people are smarter than me, but I have this phallic thing open wide.
Oh my. Alright, so that's just a little sneak peek.
Yeah.
What I love about you, Reese, and you do a lot of mainstream content too, like you do acting in the mainstream world, you do all of that. What I love is that your parody, like you have a single called Biceps, which is so fun. You're not afraid to have fun and kind of poke fun of you being in the adult industry.
Yeah. I think, and that's kind
yeah,
of...
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right.
Was that your Matthew McConaughey?
Yeah, a little bit. But that's the direction I think I want to go with Reese Rideout. It's just like crazy fun songs and parodies and things sexual, and because then you kind of jive and down that vein like we talked about. When I try and do Nick Dent, my real name, like songs, people are like, they don't give a shit. When I try and do a real movie and I put $30,000 into an independent film and try and raise money, I get $5. But then I whip out my fucking dick and I get two grand. Nobody gives a shit about my real creativity or what I...
That has to be so frustrating as an artist with, other talent.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Anyway, you can listen to Cuz Only Fans and look at the lyrics, because it's what you did. Like, it's that song.
I thought of it like 2 years ago, but I just finally got the courage to do it, because I didn't do any kind of music for a couple years because my brother passed. He was really good at music, so I haven't even touched my guitar. So I'm just getting back into it with... just a karaoke version and doing the parody with the Julie Brown song. So more to come. Stay tuned.
All right, Nick, your album released today.
It did, surprisingly to me.
Weird Kid After Party.
And there is a sequel, Sad Kid Pregame, coming.
I'm excited for this.
Yeah.
So explain your creative process. Explain what your music, because it's totally different than what we just heard.
Yeah, I mean, it's an instrumental album. It's a... sci-fi techno vibe. It meant to be played in the background of like, an after party or a pregame or whatever you want it to be, where like you could still talk to someone. Or my friends listened to it today and they're like, I could do my work, I can study, I can read, and still like have something on the background. There's a lot of uses. Or I'm like, video games, hit me up, background.
Yeah.
Because some of them sound like very, like one's called like Boss Battle or like Race Kitty. So it's so, I made a straight one too. There's 14 songs on this album. One's called Meat Music. And I made it to sound like fratty, bro, shot, like kind of music. But then
sell it to Next Door Studios. They'll put it in their next Friday.
I know. And I started remixing a lot. And I'm like, girl, this is kind of cool. Like, I would still listen to this. So there's something for everyone there if you want to listen to it.
What is your creative process? Because when you deal with electronica, it's a little bit different than another, because you're looking at beats and tracks and all that. So what is your creative process?
Well, it's different from like a normal song structure where... you have the vocals to entertain or like to listen to, like, oh, I relate to that. But with nothing, you kind of have to entertain them with like switch ups or certain sounds that sound like satisfying or like fun to blast in the car while you're driving. So I always think about like storylines of like what's happening, or where would someone listen to this too, mostly when I create.
All right, let's take a listen of Annihilation from the album that was just released today. It's a vibe.
I like your album art.
No. That bass is amazing.
Dude, yeah.
Yeah.
I like it. It's hard, man. I like it. It's deep, dark.
Transition, yeah. Storyline. All right, I'm going to add lyrics. We're going to make it a musical.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this.
Will you use your music in your content?
I mean, I think OnlyFans doesn't want to hear, like...
This is pretty sexy.
It is sexy.
It could, yeah.
It also has throwback to, like, 90s goth, like Rammstein.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. It's very Rammstein to me. All right.
Nice job, man. Yeah, yeah, I really like that. I might work out to that. I think that'd be good pumping
no,
weights.
Yeah.
Get your testosterone going.
Both music is available for streaming today.
Today, yeah. Or when this releases, it's out now, you know.
Yeah. What fun. You know, we talked about everything. And what I love is for my audience to see adult content creators in a different way, talking about like life beyond the lens. There's a lot going on.
Yeah.
Do any of you want to send a message to those that might not be such a fan of the adult industry and say something to them?
Live and let live.
You know, I think don't let your own preconceived notions limit other people's freedoms and like fun. And I think there's room for all of us to coexist in a way. What would you say?
What would I say?
Yeah, let's hear it.
I think people tend to be like most reactive against things that they're either afraid of or jealous of.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'd say watch more porn.
Yeah, learn some things, yeah.
100%. I was raised in such a Catholic home that experiencing sex came so later in life.
Yes.
And God, it messed with my brain because of that. I would have been a healthier person mentally with sex too and relationships if we had just started talking about this early. Like I said, we talk about it all, girl. Where can people find and follow you? Reese Rideout.
ReeseRideout.club is my website because somebody years ago stole ReeseRideout.com. Still trying to get it back.
But it was Ellen DeGeneres. She's like, I own the rights to this.
So, yeah, there. And then, you know, your socials. You got ReeseRideoutXXX on Twitter, X, and then the ReeseRideout on IG. And then you'll find the rest from there.
And AI.
Yeah, you'll find a link somehow. Yep. Search it. Google.
Text him. It's unreal because I know you, and I've texted this AI. It's unreal.
It's great. You got to talk to me.
Yeah.
And I'll talk right. And I'll never forget your birthday. And I'll know exactly where you like to travel, and I'll never forget that. So come talk to me.
Nick Floyd.
I mean, I'm pretty much OF Nick Floyd everywhere, which it used to be like OnlyFans, but now it's like, girl, that's official. That's OF or official.
I thought it was OnlyFans, but it's official.
I mean, it used to be, but then I think you brought up YouTube. It's just Nick_Floyd. And then music, I'm actually Nick Floyd, just the normal name. There's actually a priest, Nick Floyd, that we're competing for internet
space. I saw
this
when I first Googled. I was like,
yeah, family church. Family church, yeah.
Yeah. I actually love that dynamic because most of his congregation is going to be like, I'll just take a look.
You know, I did in religious porn too, and I hope to be like messaged, but he never contacted me. Sad, maybe for the best because he has kids and stuff. But
we didn't talk about religious porn. That's I'm still thing, not on board with that. But
no. But thank you,
Addie. Where can we find and follow you?
If you want to see the shorts I wear to work, it's Addie West Hollywood on Instagram.
Yes, I do.
Girl, it's a view. As a gay man, it's a view. Even I'm like,
cupcakes.
We got cupcakes.
I think it's a little more than cupcakes, honestly.
Oh, look at let her go. thank you, audience, for being part of our After Dark. You know, every now and then we do an After Dark episode. It gets a little naughtier, it gets a little bawdier, but I think it's important for the conversation. You know, we bring you people from all aspects of entertainment. So thank you for hanging out with us. And it's always a grab bag of fun here every week on The Rocks. A big thank you to our engineer and station owner, Tony Sweet, our social media clip editor, Alexis Mendez. Coming up, we have 70s music star and Jesus Christ Superstar original cast member who played Mary Magdalene, I Don't Know How to Love Him, and then three other 70s hits. Yvonne Elliman is coming in. We also have one of the stars from Amazon Prime's Dance Life, who's only here in LA for 4 weeks from Australia. He is taking off. Cannot wait to talk to him. Also, we have some, speaking of dance, we have some Dance Moms action. Anybody a fan of Dance Moms? You have no idea what's on the horizon. Nobody needs to shake their head. We're all a fan of Dance Moms. Surprise, surprise! All that is coming up. Please like, share, subscribe so we can continue bringing this fabulous programming coming your way for free. Until next time, stay happy, stay healthy, stay sexy. And if you drink, stay tipsy. Hey.
This has been another episode of On the Rocks. Tweet me and slide into my DMs on Twitter and Instagram at On the Rocks On Air. Find everything On the Rocks for free at ontherocksradioshow.com. Subscribe, like, review, and share. Until next week, stay fabulous.